This industry is about innovation. Innovation comes with risks. So it was really about creating this culture of risk-taking, following the science. You cannot commercialize innovative medicine if you don't understand the science behind those products.
Innovation is everywhere, but the biopharmaceutical sector sits in a category of its own, changing the outlook for widespread chronic illnesses and offering hope for debilitating rare diseases and cancer. UK-based AstraZeneca has been a pioneer in groundbreaking medicine, from the breast cancer treatment tamoxifen in the 1970s to more recent breakthroughs in cancer, cardiovascular disease, and respiratory health. Still, the path hasn't always been easy. When Pascal Soriot stepped in as CEO in 2012, the company was grappling with patent expirations, a lackluster pipeline, and poor R&D productivity. Pascal's strategy to put science front and center and invest for long-term growth is paying dividends today. As an equity analyst covering European biopharmaceuticals, I wanted to learn more about how Pascal revamped AstraZeneca. So I sat down with him at AstraZeneca's headquarters, where we talked about what winning looks like to him, the role of artificial intelligence and machine learning in drug development, and the promise of smart chemotherapy. Pascal, it's great to see you again. Thank you for joining me.
Thank you for having me.
Just to start, I noticed you trained us in veterinary medicine before you moved into pharmaceutical sales. So can you help us understand that early change in your career and moving away from France?
I always wanted to be a vet. My mother tried to convince me to be a doctor. My brothers are doctors. She convinced them, but I knew what I wanted to do and started working as a vet and quickly realized I wanted to explore the world and do other things. And so joined the industry and started in finance, actually. And then from there, I was sent to New Zealand as a rep. And that was the beginning of my career in the industry.
And I think we first met when you were at Genentech. You were the CEO there and this sort of powerhouse of innovation. How did that experience rub off on you in terms of how you work today?
It was another instance where I had to stretch myself and jump into something totally new. I was quite nervous joining such a prestigious company. It really influenced me because I discovered really a group of people who were incredibly smart, but also very committed and shared a common passion, a shared purpose, which was really to make a difference to medicine and write new chapters and medical books. And also people were very casual, very relaxed, very friendly, easygoing, but incredibly intense in how they compete and how they go about the work they do. I've kept this with me forever.
And then you moved to become CEO of AstraZeneca in 2012. When you joined the company, what were the main challenges that you faced?
So I jumped into a company that I always admired and, of course, was going through a tough time. AstraZeneca was a good company, but we had lost our focus on science and we had lost this shared purpose. And this really what I tried to rebuild over the last 10, 12 years. It was a process, I must say, because at the beginning, people didn't believe we could make it happen. But this industry is about innovation. Innovation comes with risks. And if you don't take any risk, you don't innovate. So it was really about creating this culture of risk-taking.
COVID came along, and you decided to partner with Oxford University to develop a vaccine. What was behind your decision to develop this vaccine, and what do you believe the legacy of it has been?
We have a large presence in China. We have about 18,000 employees there. We are the largest pharmaceutical company in China. And so that gave us an early window in COVID and what was happening in China. And very quickly, we realized this was going to be a big deal. Then we looked at how can we look at our portfolio of products and re-engineer some of them for COVID treatment. Then we started working on COVID antibodies. And along the way, back in April 2020, we came across the work Oxford University was doing. And immediately we thought, you know, we can help. A lot of our people could have said, it's too risky. Why are we doing this? We do it at no profit. Why? I didn't get that comment a single time. Everybody stepped in and said, okay, how can we make this work? And it's been an amazing effort for everybody. It hasn't been perfect, but we suddenly, in the end, delivered 3 billion doses and saved 6.5 million lives.
And the other thing, I guess, that COVID did was accelerate the pace of innovation.
Yeah, I mean, first of all, with COVID, we learned a lot as an organization in terms of how quickly we can move the development of a product, and we are applying some of those learnings to our portfolio. But it also really attracted everybody's attention to the importance of having a resilient healthcare system, because COVID really showed that if your healthcare system cannot cope with a pandemic, a health challenge like this one, your economy will suffer. I actually truly believe that we have to build healthcare systems that are resilient. The future of healthcare, in my opinion, is not to build more hospitals that may be needed, but it's really to use what we have in a more efficient manner. And the best way to do this beyond prevention of disease is early diagnosis and interception of disease. So you diagnose the disease and you treat patients quickly. If you have lung cancer or any cancer, you treat it early with surgery or medical therapy, you can be cured. So that's really, I think, the future of healthcare, early diagnosis and smart targeted treatments.
Another area which is a merger of biology and chemistry and technology is antibody drug conjugates, so-called ADCs. I refer to it as smart chemotherapy.
If you think about oncology, you know, very simple traditional chemotherapies, this is for me the equivalent of carpet bombing, right? And so you try to bomb something, but you create a lot of collateral damage with side effects. Fast forward to today, and really smart chemotherapy, as you call it, is the combination of a toxin with an antibody. The antibody will go and dock or bind to a receptor on the cancer cell and deliver this toxin to the cancer cell and not to the healthy cells. So you can actually target the cancer without having the collateral damage to the rest of the body. We have an entire portfolio of ADCs, and I believe they will transform the way cancer is being treated, and they will replace traditional chemotherapy. You have a whole range of technologies today. You have, of course, the traditional small molecules that have become smarter themselves, more targeted. You have biologics agents, antibodies. You have bispecific antibodies. Now we are working on cell therapy. And cell therapy is today starting to be used in essentially blood cancers, but we are working on technologies that would enable us in the future to use cell therapy off the shelf. Today, you take cells from a patient, you re-engineer them, re-inject them. It's a very complex and expensive process. If you can actually take those cells from a product that is on shelf, it will be much easier to use.
During the COVID pandemic, you decided to acquire Alexion to get into rare diseases. What was the vision here? Why did you decide to get into rare diseases?
We saw the potential to help more patients around the world. And we saw also the possibility to leverage our science with the work that Alexion was doing and come up with new products. And so we were on the way to moving from a primary care history to a specialty care. And we saw rare disease as the next step towards even more specialty care, hyper specialty care. So we saw the opportunity to actually create scientific synergies and commercial geographical synergies.
You mentioned China earlier. You're the leading pharmaceutical company in China. What are you seeing in these markets that maybe others aren't appreciating?
I've always believed in the future of China. You have, you know, 1.4 billion people who are smart, working hard. So when I joined, I thought we need to build our presence in China. And we've evolved from the early days when we were saying we are in China for China to a stage where we are in China for the world. What that means is we're not only exporting some of the products we manufacture in China, but we are now leveraging the innovation that is coming out of China. In the last 4 or 5 years in particular, innovation has exploded in China, and there are enormous opportunities to actually partner with many of those innovative research organizations, companies, and help them develop and commercialize their products globally.
Another area that you've been investing heavily in over the last 6 years is machine learning and artificial intelligence. Where are those technologies going to make the biggest difference to an organization like yours?
Well, they make a difference everywhere, very much in research. I mean, if you look at human beings, we are incredibly complex machines, right? And if you look at the number of potential targets or mechanisms in the body, you have all sorts of data sources that you need to bring together and analyze. So artificial intelligence, we use that to identify new targets, new medicines. We use it as we develop new products. We use it in our factories. We use it as we interact with physicians in the field. So artificial intelligence is totally transforming the way we operate our company.
You have a reputation for being competitive. Can you help me understand what winning means for you?
winning for us means helping as many patients as we can. And of course, it means for many of our people taking a leadership position and shaping the future of healthcare. And that's what we try to do. Being number one in itself is not necessarily the ultimate achievement, but being a leader in the industry, shaping the future of medicine, coming up with new products, and also working on other issues like equity, like sustainability, are ways for us to show our leadership and win in a broader manner.
Outside AstraZeneca, I've read that you're a keen cyclist.
I do a lot of cycling, and if you climb up a hill and you try to climb up a mountain and you go up to 2,000 meters high, it really focuses your mind and you cannot think of anything else. And it's also a great way to experience what resilience is about. It's hard, going up is hard, and getting to the top is rewarding. And that's what business is about. It's often hard, but if you get to the top, if you achieve what you want to achieve, it's rewarding.
Pascal, it's been great catching up. Thank you so much for your time. I've really enjoyed it.
Thank you, Mark. It's great to be here.